things are coming down again tonight. Water always gets people's attention. I learned that in 2011. Some people may have heard this story before, but 2011, I was a newbie. I'd never been on a city council. Somebody brought a water bill to one of our local gov committees, and the fight broke out. I had no idea what was going on. It didn't matter what side of the alley we were on. Just that somebody was messing with somebody's water. So now we got a lake run going down and groundwater is disappearing. So as you might imagine, as you all know, it's a very complicated, very difficult issue spanning several state agencies, cities, regions, and across the whole state. So what we've been trying to do in the last few years, former Representative McFarland and others have been doing this for several years. I was on the first meeting of my first year. So we've been working hard to develop some ideas. We've developed legislation. We know some of that. We're not going to go over that. And we had some legislation this year. Studies have been going on. So what we're going to do tonight is we've got plenty of water. Bears we need. We have plenty of water. Plenty of water. It's just how we manage it. And if we do this right, with the right approach, all these communities working together, we can manage this process and everybody will be as happy as they can be. This is not going to make everybody happy when they come out with the final solution, but in my humble opinion, we have people who believe nothing is wrong. We have people to say the sky is falling. Somewhere in between is the answer. I personally believe there is a problem, both surface water and groundwater. We've got plenty of it. We just have to manage it better. And there's a lot of opportunity here. We do this right, work together with the state departments and everybody else. We can all have plenty of sustainable water into the distant future for our communities. We can have plenty of control of that water, and your citizens will not be paying for something they don't get. So that is our goal. That is our objective. So for tonight, what's going to happen is I'm going to introduce Representative Dean. He's going to say a few words. Senator Wiger wants to say a couple things. And then Representative Fischer is going to go over legislation from last year. The legislation last year that did several different things that I thought were good ideas. After that, DNR will come up and give a brief update on where they're at with the groundwater management system, those areas. There's not just this region, but there's areas in other places in the state where they have established groundwater management areas. But they'll give us an update on where we're at in this area. They also have some other people from other departments, Bowser and DOH. Their plan is to give about a minute brief of what they're doing with their piece of the legislation and their money. After that, then we get the Met Council and the famous report. And they'll give us an update of where they're at. You got the executive summary, I think most of you do. They'll talk to us about it. So our plan is be us done talking by 6:40. 6:40 we're done talking. Done talking at 6:40. And get you folks to start giving your input and feedback, and then these people can answer your questions, all right? So I'm done. Thank you very much for being here. Representative Dean has a few words to say, and then Senator Wiggle. Thank you.
Thanks, Senator Chamberlain. My name is Matt Dean and represent Local Area 38B in the Minnesota House. Thank you for coming. It's an important issue that we have. It's the number one issue in my district that I hear from folks about is water in White Bear Lake. And I have represented both sides of the lake before and after redistricting, so I've represented everybody who lives around the lake, but as we all know, the lake affects the community surrounding the lake and indeed regionally. It's a very important thing both for our economy, for our quality of life, for everybody who lives in the community. So it's very, very important to us. With water loss in the last several years, we've been looking at that, what's causing it, and what can we do about it. I think we have seen in the last 6 years, I have personally seen and backed this up with research and with polling of the folks in the area, that people have gone from it's just dry and low to there's something wrong that's bigger. And that is now about 75 to 80% of the people who respond believe that this is not just a low period in rainfall, that there is indeed something else going on. I have been pretty consistent in my work on this is that I'm going to be very unashamedly parochial. I will measure success by how many gallons of water we can put and keep in the lake over time. Pretty simple. So I've been a little frustrating for probably some of my friends at the DNR and Met Council as well with that, but I feel that is my job. to do. I was very encouraged this year when Representative Fischer brought forward a bonding proposal to augment the waters in the lake to try to keep it up. We worked very hard to keep that in the bonding bill. And right up until the last moment, I was encouraged that that was going to be funded in a supplemental funding bill, which I said if it was indeed funded in that way, that I would support the bill, quote unquote, no matter how ugly it is, which I was the only Republican to vote for it because at that point, that's what it was. So I'm very encouraged by that, and I'm going to remain hopeful that indeed is continued to be looked at by the folks at the Met Council and the DNR, as was the legislative intent coming out of the House. And I will be vigilant and perhaps annoyingly so as I pursue that. So with that, I'm just going to apologize in advance to my friends and the agency for continuing to be a little bit overly persistent on that issue, but I will not back off of that, because in the legislature, your word means something. If you can't give your word and stand behind it, then you don't have anything else. That's all you got, basically. So I'm going to hold those folks to their commitments to me, and they seem that I've done the best I can to hold on to my end of that work as well. So I'm looking forward to hearing from the community and also from the agencies here. I think from the attendance tonight, you can see just how important that this issue is to this community. So thank you.
A few words. Chuck Wiger, and isn't it ironic that tonight at, I believe, midnight, they're going to lift the wake restrictions at Minnetonka with all the abundance of water and the problems that they're enduring. We have the same aquifer and still a challenge in the other part of the metro area. We all know the issue in terms of what needs to be addressed in this area, and as legislators, in a bipartisan way, we are working to try to provide a long-term solution. You're going to hear some recommendations soon from the Metropolitan Council, efforts that are going on right now. I have sponsored proposals that would help us get to a solution, a constructive long-term solution. So my role here tonight is to actively listen. Appreciate your attendance and look forward to your feedback.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming tonight. I'm going to review a little bit what happened legislatively this past time around, but I want to set the stage a little bit before I start in that, is letting everyone know that a lot of things that happened legislatively happened with a number of people working together. It was not just one or two people. We had a lot of active involvement from the local White Bear Chamber was very involved as we were putting things together. The St. Paul Chamber was also very involved as we were trying to craft the legislation. A lot of the legislation that we had come through was also done in a very bipartisan way. There were a number of proposals that came through the House that I remember working with Representative Runback, Representative Dean on to help try to make sure that we got through, that applied to many different areas. And the reason that we're having so many people involved across the way is because as we've been addressing the water issue, it's not just a White Bear Lake issue, it's a regional issue about groundwater. And it's not just one thing that's going to take care of it. It's going to take a number of different solutions to try to address the problem as we go forward. Some of the things that we were addressing as we're going through is that there was about $950,000 that we had approved in the supplemental bill. And $100,000 of that went to the Board of Water and Soil Resources and the Pollution Control Agency to investigate the feasibility of collecting and treating stormwater in the northeast metro area here to enhance surface water and to facilitate groundwater recharge. And when you hear enhanced surface water, that means a couple of things. Surface water enhancement means making sure that we've got water quality being addressed because we've got a high quality issue here with White Bear Lake. And also because White Bear Lake is connected to that lower aquifer, any kind of water that might be enhancing that, we want to make sure it's high quality, because eventually whatever goes in will end up in our drinking water supply. So we have to be very thoughtful about how we approach these things going forward. There was $50,000 that went to the University of Minnesota's Technical Assistance Program to identify opportunities for industrial water users to reduce or reuse their water consumption within the Northeast Metro water area. That's because we're so used to taking the water, using it one time, and then flushing it away. There are many opportunities to be reusing it. We have to think about how we do this differently. And so this is another solution that is a possibility out there that we're wanting to make sure is being addressed in the process. Another thing was $150,000 to collaborate with the Department of Health and local governments to identify strategies that would contribute to groundwater recharge, surface water enhancement, and wellhead protection. This gets into another way is how do we, all these different water features that we have in the landscape impact our drinking water, not only in the ground, but also on the surface areas. Another thing was $100,000 for public work professionals and local governments to develop landscaping best practices. And what we're looking at is things that would help keep water on the landscape, but more importantly, to start getting communities to think about different ways about how they're having landscaping done. And where this was very highlighted, it was just a few weeks ago that there was a report in the paper that during the heavy rain and extended rain periods that we had at the beginning of June, Woodbury reported that they used twice as much water in the middle of a 2-inch rainstorm as they did in the winter when you don't have any pumping at all. And they were figuring that a lot of that was going to people who had irrigation systems that were still running while we were all drowning in water elsewhere. And so it's important that we start taking a look at it, encouraging cities to figure out what are other best landscape management practices we can do, which can also help businesses still having something attractive out there that does not need the same maintenance or the same water, help save businesses costs. So I think these are some win-win opportunities we also have that are going to be coming down the road. Another thing is $150,000 for wetland restoration and groundwater recharge in the Northeast metropolitan area. Once again, it's very critical is when you take a look at that besides White Bear Lake, there are other areas that are connected to the aquifer that we eventually pump out. What are we doing to making sure that we're protecting that so we aren't losing recharge? Because as we lose recharge, that means it takes more to try to get the aquifer to bounce back up. Those were some of the bigger things that we did in terms of what we appropriated money for. There were some other enforcement steps that we did and some things that we did in terms of governmental structure. One of them is there is a water management area work group that is established in the area. And one of the things that we did in a very bipartisan way is DNR has done a good job of pulling together, but it's kind of a learning process. And one of the things that we want to do is make sure that there was good representation at the table in a fair way for not only businesses, but for also the local communities. And so we were able to tweak that process to make sure that we've got a good collaborative group, because we realize that whatever we're doing here, this is the first time this is rolling out in the state. We've got 16 other areas in the state that are having problems. So we're going to want to make sure that we're setting up a good model that can be used and replicated elsewhere. Another thing that we also made sure is that giving the DNR the tools so that when people are violating permits, they've got stronger tools to go in and address those who are violating permits. That's a key thing, because when people are being very responsible for those permits, the bad eggs in the room you want to make sure are being dealt with in a very appropriate way so that they're not having an unfair advantage otherwise. So those are some things that we had that were done. As you notice by what I outlined here, that we put money into a number of different agencies to start working and helping address the problem. And so what I'd like to do is give the opportunity for some of the agencies to come up, give a real quick presentation. We're going to start with the DNR. Jason Meckel will come up and tell a little bit about the DNR. We'll pass it off to Board of Soil and Water Resources, the Department of Health. Eventually we'll get to the Met Council, who's had their big report that has just come out. When we finish with that, then we'll come back with questions. So at this point, where is Jason? Oh, there he is. So Jason, if you'd like to come up.
Great, thank you. Good evening, Jason Meckel, Department of Natural Resources. We'll try to keep this brief because we know we want to move along. Representative Fischer and the others just provided a nice overview of things that happened in the legislature. And I want to speak to one of the last ones, which is the change for the project advisory team. When we started out with the groundwater management area, we said we want to get some people from the outside to help advise us as we start to develop plans. And so we just started contacting local units of government. We said, who do you think we should bring in? We started contacting permittees. Who do you think we should bring in and help us and advise us? We contacted the other agents. We contacted USGS. And we invited a bunch of folks, and we started having meetings and started to think about what would a plan look like for what we can do in the groundwater management area of the North and East Metro. So we were figuring it out as we went along. And as Representative Fischer said, this last year, the legislature gave us a little bit more specific guidance about the structure and organization of the project advisory teams. And what they said is that we got to make sure that at least 50% of the people on our advisory team have a permit from us to appropriate water. So as a result of that, we've sent out some letters asking for additional names for the North and East Metro We have about 20 people on the group now, and we need to add about three more to get the 50% number to match up. So we've asked the Association of Counties, Metro Cities, League of Minnesota Cities, Townships, and others, if they know of any permittees or suggestions of people that we could add to the group. We've had a few communities that have been attending the meetings that haven't been on the project advisory team, and we think some of those folks might be interested in joining our effort. And before I forget, I see a few of our PAT members here. Could I get you guys to just stand up? Ryan, I see you, Bill, a couple, at least a couple folks here. So I'm going really quick, summarizing many months of work here that you guys have been helping us with. As I said, we started this last October, held some large meetings, brought a bunch of invited in permittees from all around the North and East Metro area, which includes all of Washington County, Ramsey County, and parts of Anoka County. So large area. It's not just around White Bear Lake where we're concerned about groundwater use and water sustainability. And then we started this PAT, this Project Advisory Team, meeting on a monthly basis. They've been giving us advice and feedback about the kinds of things that we need to do to ensure that our water use is sustainable in this part of the state now and into the future. And one of the things we recognize is it's not just about our current water use. And we're using more than we ever have before, 3 billion gallons or more groundwater use in the state of Minnesota every year on average. But it's also about what are we going to be doing 20 years from now. And as we met with communities, one of the things we learned is that and recognizes that we spend money on infrastructure that has a life cycle, 30, 40, 50 years. You put pipe, you put infrastructure in the ground. That stuff costs money. We don't want to be putting that stuff in and then find out later that it was not a good choice, that it's not a sustainable way to develop and to use water. So part of the groundwater management is to help us figure out how much water can we depend on from the ground? What other sources make sense? What other ways can we use to reduce or conserve water? Those kinds of things. That's part of what we're trying to figure out with the groundwater management. The other things Representative Fischer just mentioned briefly about enforcement tools. One of the things that we don't have this problem so much in the metro area, but in greater Minnesota, we have had an issue where people have been appropriating large amounts of water without getting permits. And that's really an important thing so we can keep track of how much we're using so that we can evaluate the trends and what we're seeing over time. And the legislature gave us some authority this year that we can go after and more efficiently pursue the folks that just don't want to comply with law. Okay, so that was a big enhancement. We appreciate the legislature's support on that. The other thing I guess I'll just mention, I know folks are probably watching. Does everybody here know that our website now has real-time water level data on White Bear Lake? I've seen heads nod. Okay, not everybody is. This is amazing. You know, this is the only lake in the state where you can go to the website and see what the water level readings are on that lake this morning, this afternoon, this evening. And quite a few of us have made a habit of checking it on a regular basis. And what's interesting is that we're learning a lot about this. We only put this in just last year, but we've got a rain gauge there. We're watching rain and we're watching the lake. And then we're watching what's happening in the West Metro this year. Record rainfalls in Twin Cities. We talk about Lake Minnetonka and the no wake restrictions coming off here tomorrow. That part of the state, that part of the metro received over 13.5 inches of rain in the month of June. We had a little over 7 inches of rain at White Bear Lake at the gauge that we have installed. And what we saw was in the month of June, that 7 inches of rain resulted in just about a foot of water level increase in the lake. So what we're learning more now is how precipitation and water levels are interacting, as well as now with the groundwater monitoring installations that we have in and around the lake and the ones that we're adding, we're learning a lot more about the relationship here. White Bear Lake is not Minnetonka. They're very different. The geology is very different. And Minnetonka got a lot more water and it's much higher, as we've just been talking about. So I'm just going to wrap it up there, and I know you guys are going to have questions, but we just wanted to give you a quick update. I'm sorry, one more thing. The project advisory team for the groundwater management area has been meeting for several months. We will have a draft plan that we're going to bring to the project advisory team starting in August and again in September at their meetings. We're going to get their feedback, incorporate their additional ideas in that plan to the extent we can, and then we will have a broader set of stakeholder opportunities, something maybe like this, something maybe a little different, we haven't figured that out yet, where we'll let other people review, learn about, and tell us what they think about our plan and what we're going to do at the DNR for the next several years to make sure that we're on a path for sustainable water use in this part of the metropolitan area. So be looking for that around September, October. And then we hope to have it wrapped up and finalized by hopefully the month of December sometime. All right, now I'm going to turn it over to Randy. No, Randy, yes. Randy's going to talk about wellhead protection stuff and how this stuff relates.
All right. Well, thank you, Jason. I'm Randy Ellingbow with the Minnesota Department of Health, Section of Drinking Water Protection. And it's nice to be here tonight. We've had staff at some of these meetings previously, but this is, I think, the first time we've participated formally in this. And so, like, the invitation and the opportunity to talk to you tonight. And I'll talk briefly about some of the funding that we got in this last legislative session to work with our partners. We regularly work with the various folks here from the Met Council, from the Board of Water and Soil Resources, the Pollution Control Agency, the Department of Natural Resources on a variety of particularly groundwater related issues. Our program at the Department of Health works with public water supplies to make sure that they meet the federal drinking water standards so that the water that's supplied through public water supplies to your taps is safe and meets all the federal standards. We also work with those public water supplies, though, to protect the groundwater sources from potential sources of contamination. And so these public water supplies are required to prepare wellhead protection plans, that is, plans to look at the areas around the wells and potential sources of contamination and prevent those from contaminating these drinking water supplies. That's our primary role. And so we work within your communities with those public water supplies on that effort. And the funding that we got here as it relates to the North and East Metro groundwater area is first of all, to collaborate with the Board of Water and Soil Resources on some of the efforts you'll hear about in just a few minutes. And also to work with local governments on these various efforts to protect groundwater. We also have an interest in meeting these sustainability standards that are so crucial to the ground and surface water resources in this area. Things that we're thinking about, we still need to do some additional planning on these efforts. We're just getting started on that. But among the activities we will be looking into to work with this funding are to update the community wellhead protection plans with information that will come out from the studies Met Council is doing, as well as some studies being conducted in this area by the U.S. Geological Survey. There's an awful lot of work going on here. Our goal is to work cooperatively to help community public water supplies use that information as they do their planning efforts. There are a lot of wells in this region up here, and in looking at protecting the areas around these wells, sometimes the protection zones cross community boundaries, cross city boundaries, and of course groundwater is not restricted by the political boundaries of cities and counties and so on. And so one of the things that we think might be of help is if we can help communities look across boundaries and share efforts on this wellhead protection effort that they're going about. We'll be coordinating with our partners in providing information to communities. The DNR, Board of Water and Soil Resources, Pollution Control Agency, Met Council all have a lot of information that they work on within their own areas of expertise, their own responsibilities, and so we work to try to maximize the efforts that come out of these various cross-agency responsibilities so that we can maximize the benefit, particularly for the local communities. So I'll end with that. Basically, our job here is to help communities better protect their wells, their groundwater resources. We're going to do that by enhancing the information and its availability for the locals, working with our state agency partners. So, thanks.
Good evening. I'm Sarah Stroman. I'm with the Board of Water and Soil Resources, or Bowser. I'm going to be really brief here. Our role in this arena is that by statute, we are linked to local units of government, soil and water districts, watershed districts, cities through the Watershed Management Organization, and counties. We're linked in local water management and local water planning. And so specifically, the money that we received through this last legislative session is for us to leverage the work of our other agencies that you've either heard from or will hear from, to take the information that they pull together and to work with the local units of government on incorporating that information and those strategies into the local plans that are already existing. So this might be city comprehensive plans, watershed district plans, watershed management organization plans, or county water or groundwater plans. And by incorporating those strategies and having those implementation plans, it positions the communities for future funding for specific activities, whether that be groundwater protection activities or activities that keep water on the land. I'll also just say, because we're sort of the end of this process as we get closer to the implementation, we're still working on the specific mechanisms of how all this partnership will work, but that really is on our role, is translating the information and the strategies to the implementation. So I will turn it over to the Met Council, and I will be around for questions later.
Good evening. My name is Ali Elhassan. I'm the manager of Water Supply Planning with the Metropolitan Council. Thanks for inviting us to give an update on the draft report of what we have been doing over the last year. I would like to start by taking us back about a year ago when we started in the same place here in Century College. We invited all the stakeholders to come and provide input on what we are planning to do at that time. At that time, we received direction from the legislature to carry out planning activities with regard to reliability and sustainability of water supply for the entire region, for the entire metro area, including the northeast, because of the issues that observed in White Bear Lake and other lakes around the metro area. So at that time, the Met Council received a $2 million appropriation to study or analyze the reliability and sustainability of the water supply for the entire metropolitan area. As you know, the Met Council is a regional planning agency for water supply. We are not a provider. We are not a regulator. We are the planning agency for the area for the long-term sustainability of the entire metro area. Since that time, or even before that, since 2012, and I took this position in 2012, my first task was go and fix White Bear Lake. And now 2 years I'm trying, believe me, I'm trying very hard. And the first job was to go and attend meetings with the stakeholders in the region. And I went there, and I was really impressed with the engagement of the stakeholders. We have been engaged with those communities. We have been engaged with different stakeholders in the region for the last 2 years. And I can tell you that in sometimes during the last 2 years, I have been in White Bear Lake area every week at least once or twice, attending meetings and meetings with different stakeholders in the region. And through our work with the stakeholders, we came up with a list of 16 approaches. And all of those approaches were very good approaches. It's just no one knew at that time how much it's going to make or create a benefit, how much it will cost, and which one is feasible from an engineering standpoint. This list of approaches, when we went through different screening process with the stakeholders, and I can name so many of those, and I can see a lot of the stakeholders who have been involved in this process in this room today. And at the end, we selected the three approaches with the help of the communities that we wanted to study under this appropriation. And those approaches that with the community selected and the stakeholders selected and provided to Met Council to analyze, we're trying to balance between to improve the general groundwater levels in the region, the regional impact on our aquifers, how we can reduce that impact, as well as how that will improve the lake level. And all of this work was based on different historic studies that were done by USGS, Department of Natural Resources, and other entities. So there were three or four basic questions that were asked to Met Council from the stakeholders that they need answers for. And this is what we are trying to provide in this information, in this report. The first question, can we build it? Is it, what's the engineering configuration for building any one of those approaches? The second question, how much it will cost? What's the capital cost? What's the operational cost for each one of those approaches? And the third question is, could we evaluate other criteria, not only cost, but impact on the aquifer, impact on water levels in the lake or surface water features, implementability of all of those projects, how long it will take to implement any one of those approaches, what kind of permits that's needed for each one of those approaches. And the last question and the big question is, how can we fund it? And that's the big question that we are still working on that. What are the sources for funding that's available for the communities that can tap into so that they can get those projects implemented? And also, there's other questions about what are the fair cost share mechanisms that could be used between the communities so that they were not creating winners and losers in any new system in the region. And so with that, the Met Council took into this study, and I hope that everyone had a chance to take a look at the report that we released yesterday, at least the executive summary, and we tried our best that we put as much information that's useful for anyone in that executive summary so that people can have an idea of where we're heading and what's need to be done in the future. I'm not planning to go into details on what are the key findings and all of those of that report at this point, because I have only, I think,
10 minutes.
Six minutes.
All
right. I was hoping for 10. So, but one of the, a couple of other things that we wanted to share with the communities. We are a resource to the communities. We are the planning agency. It's very important to understand that we are not the implementation agency for any one of those approaches. It's in the hands of the communities, it's on the hands of the stakeholders in this region to implement any one of those approaches. If you notice in this executive summary and the report that we released yesterday, we didn't have any recommendations. We didn't say that communities need to do that, because part of this is we didn't arrive into what kind of recommendations we are going to say at this point. There is some work that needs to be done. There is more analysis that we're continuing. And we are planning to release this by the end of October of this year, when we are releasing our final report. So again, it's back to the communities who need to make the decision about what kind of approaches they need to implement. It's not my job as a planning agency in telling you what to do. It's your job that you are implementing whatever approaches that you want to do. And actually, also, we didn't have any conclusions in the report at this time, because we didn't reach any conclusions. For the final report, there's a couple of questions that we didn't have enough information to answer at this point, and we are hoping that by the final report we're going to get some information. A good example of that is, what is the seepage rate from the lake to the aquifer? We don't have that information. And just I want to assure you that we are working closely with the USGS, and Terry Jones is here, and I would like to invite you to give a 1 minute or 2 minutes, just.
That's okay. Give you extra time for that.
Because we have been talking with USGS about what kind of information that could be available between now and October that we can implement in our analysis, that could refine our analysis and improve the information that we're providing to communities. And Perry Jones, they have been working hard over the last year or so in developing more information that's answering some of the lingering questions that we have from last year. How much seepage? Where are those locations where the seepage is happening? And we would like to implement as much information that's available from USGS at that time before we release our final report. With that, I would like to invite Perry Jones, and please go easy on us on questions, because this is just a draft report. We are still working on this, and we continue to engage all of you while we're developing the final report.
Okay, I've got 1 minute, so I'll do it briefly. So the issue is how much water is going down from the lake down into the deeper aquifers. This is just one of the issues we're looking at in our study. We've got a three-year study we started last year, and we're working on coming up with an answer. And people who've been on the lake may have seen we installed some piezometers back in March when we had ice, and we put in wells that actually go down into the lake sediments. And what we wanted to do was to see what kind of pressure conditions are in the sediments below the lake and compare that to the lake level to see what are we seeing some kind of pressure gradient that would indicate downward flow or upward flow. And so we did this at four locations, and we actually did some work back in last November doing some geophysical work to identify what the bottom of the sediments look like on the lake. And we did it throughout the entire lake, and we picked out four locations where we could put in piezometers. So at those locations, we were able to measure head differences, and we installed 3 to 2 wells at each of these four sites, and we put them at different depths to try to understand what that flow rate might be going either upward or downward. And on top of that, we were working with some scientists from USGS in Denver, and they work with seepage meters. And I don't know how many have seen our report, we did prior to it, we did a lot of seepage meter work around the outside of the lake to understand what kind of groundwater flow rates might be coming in or out in the shallow portions of the lake. Well, these are all our sites we selected in the deep of it, because we were thinking we didn't even know very much about that in these deeper locations. And so what we did was we had these large seepage mirrors, we put those down into the lakes, we were able to measure flow, and at all the sites we were measuring downward flow. In other words, water from the lake was going down into the deeper sediments in the lake. We also, when we looked at the head conditions or the water level conditions in the piezometers versus what was in the lake, we constantly would see a lower pressure condition in the wells than what was in the lake. Again, which indicates, again, downward flow in that lake. And we're going back out there third week in August. We're gonna take some more measurements now at a different level. Obviously the lake is at a much higher level at this point, and we're gonna wait to see what it's gonna look like in August. And we'll get more measurements. And these are measurements that then they can use with either groundwater flow modeling, and we plan to do some of this work, but the Met Council can use those numbers to come up and try to come up with estimates then of the seepage flow, outflow. It's just one component in the lake budget, but other components, and they can use that to come up with estimates of how effective maybe, how effective that augmentation might be. In the lake. So. Thank you, Perry. Yep. Okay, we're going to move into questions and comments here very shortly. I just want to kind of set the stage here a little bit as we move into it. Is what we're trying to do is try to get people's questions answered and also take comments. Is one of the things that we've been trying to do as we've facilitated these processes over the last couple of years is try to make sure that we've got plenty of input. And this is a very important thing, not only from the region, from the state, all the way down. And what I want to do is kind of recognize that we do have a lot of people who are interested in what's going on. We do have a lot of elected officials here. I just kind of want to very quickly recognize, I know there's a lot of people from city councils and who are mayors here. If you could just kind of raise your hand so people can see the different folks that we have representing the different from the townships and the communities. We also have, I know, some county commissioners. I see one over here. Is there anyone from Washington County? Okay, we've got Victoria. And then also from the legislative side, besides those of us that have been up here, we've got Senator Scalzi. I know I've seen Representative Lilly, Representative Runback, Representative Detmeyer, Representative Ward in the back there. Did I miss any of the reps or the senators? Kind of gives you an idea of the breadth of the seriousness that we're taking this with. We're here to hear the questions and the comments that you folks have, because we're going to be addressing this not only on a regional level, but there's going to be policy coming forward to the state. And so what we hear here today, tonight, is something that we're going to be bringing forward as we're addressing things as we move down the road on this. So at this point in time, I'd like to open it up to questions that people have. Starting in the back, third row up on the end, the gentleman in kind of a Hawaiian type shirt there.
There we go. Tom Bates, Manamita. The lake's up a little bit, somewhat. Short-term kind of help for it, perhaps, that wouldn't cost a lot of money and get us up, you know, a little bit farther. Goose Lake's been brimming for a couple of years. Why not put a culvert across the street? That's not going to cost a lot of money. You bring that down about 2 feet. Same with Lost Lake down here. That Lost Lake is everything storm sewered from right down the road here and there. And that's brimming at times. There's a culvert already goes White Bear Lake, but it's way high. It only trips into the lake when the road's just about to go under. Why not take that down a couple of feet? Those two things would help, I think, bring the level up a little bit more. Jermaine Creek hardly flows anymore. We could clean out that swamp area on the other side of the road, and Long Lake from over where my house is. Keep those culverts and creeks open, and clean up that slough in there, and we get some more water back to Jermaine Creek like we used to. And I think those three things wouldn't cost a lot of money, be done quickly, and would, you know, the lake's up already a little bit, would help some more. That's just a thought.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
Right behind you, the gentleman in the dark shirt, gray, I think that is?
Yeah, Tim Dewoski, resident of Matamina. First of all, I'd like to say thank you for having this meeting and the opportunity to express opinions and listening. You talked about groundwater, you talked about surface water. I'd like to talk about the aquifer that runs to the west. All the other aquifers run to the east to the St. Croix. There's one aquifer which runs to the west. And to border it for you would be Jeffrey Avenue to where Northport Airport to the west. That all runs to the west. Okay?
That includes Long Lake, Matamita, Willarney, White Bear, Birchwood, Lost Lake, Echo Lake, and areas of Grant.
I have a report here from 1990 from the University of Minnesota. The gentleman here in front of you is talking about Lost Lake. I happen to live on that lake. That lake is contaminated with mercury. There's 25 years worth of testing data that's been done that I have access to on that lake, surrounding lakes, and White Bear Lake. This report in 1990 shows the sensitivity of groundwater pollution to Lost Lake very high. That was back in 2012, here's the same report, still high. Now keep in mind those boundaries that I just gave you, okay? You built a new elementary school up there on the Bel Air sanitation site, okay? That documentation from 1992, distance the nearest school, zero. Well, that's funny, they built a new school there. This is from the Washington County Public Health. He's not sure of all of the location or trenches, but one of them is in the location of the old burn area. He knows the location of some of the demolition dumps, but not all of them. Is there a high possibility or a threat to any nearby drinking water wells by migration of hazardous substances? Yes. Identified. The on-site well and private wells located to the three residents south to 75th Street. Is there a high possibility of a threat to any of the following? Sensitivity to the environment, wetland, critical habitat, yes. Is there a high possibility of an area of superficial contamination within 200 feet of any resident school or daycare facility? Yes.
Now mind you, that aquifer that runs,
that's
that
direction, the same aquifer I'm talking
goes
about,
to White Bear Lake and Lost Lake. It's the only one in the state. The rest of them flush in this area. It's like the beginning point for the ones that go up north towards St. Cloud, Rainier, all that area. Then it kind of loops around, comes down, and then it shifts back to the east.
Right. We're getting notes on it right here. So
okay, keep
through
your pencil going, because I have some very sensitive information here.
If we can, and we can also move along, because I know there's a lot of other people that
I'd
like to make.
I realize that. It was an unregulated dump. Because of the high water table in the area, the dumps are estimated only to be 10 to 15 feet deep. Storage of paint, solvents, industrial coatings, junk automobile, white goods, 55-gallon drum, petroleum spills have been reported. Petroleum paint bottom sludge was spread on the capped dump. Facilities record of violations include non-compliance and a stipulation agreement from May 15, 1986. This is what they call the superior lobe, okay? Mm-hmm. Talking about drinking water, and I'm glad you brought that up, because I went and had my drinking water tested. It came back today positive. 100 to 200 feet thick serves as a source of water for domestic wells. The depth of the groundwater has been estimated to be approximately 15 feet deep and found as depths as 2 to 10 feet.
Our well is approximately 70 to 80 feet deep.
Three homes on the south side, 200 feet away, had contamination in 1992. And I talked to one of those people a couple days ago. They don't know that their contamination exists out there. When you built that new school out in Matamita that everybody enjoys so much, I have documentation from the Department of Labor and Industry. They had to stay 10 feet, maintain a 10 feet separation between the contamination. How did they maintain a 10 foot separation when the contamination was already 200 feet to the south? And now I have it in my lake, which is going into White Bear Lake, just like the gentleman in front of me referred to, and now I have it in my drinking water. Let me read you the last paragraph of a letter from White Bear Lake. The mayor and city council share your concern for water quality and will continue to monitor the conditions. But based on the information received from stated and regional agencies, it does not appear the condition of Lost Lake is a threat to White Bear Lake. If that isn't a threat, I don't know what is.
Thank you. Appreciate your comments and inputs there. Okay. Other questions, comments that I see? Yes, sir.
Yeah, Larry Lanoe. I'm also from the city of Grand Terre. Recently, and Matt Dean just got up, he said the senator's word means something. I went to the Senate. We introduced a bill that said no school is built within a quarter mile of a dump, and if so, we'd give public notification. If toxins exceed residential levels, which would prohibit it. We have some great people working on it on both sides. We had a Democratic-controlled deal in the state.
I hate to interrupt, but
this is what I'm saying. I will get that.
So if we can try to tie
before we report, did that, please. Minnesota Superfund site number, Bel Air Sanitation, and I got the number for it here. I've been working with Erin Brockovich, and she was concerned before they built this school on a dump site. She's very concerned about, especially if you go through contaminated sites.
Now
Representative Fischer, what we're saying is we came to your legislature before it got built, asked for help. The Democrats never got under. Senator Wiger represents Modern United School District. You do. Okay. The Democrats did not allow the bill to get on the legislature in the environmental committee.
What we brought this session together, I'm hearing some people are unhappy because they've got concerns and questions about what's happened with the White Bear Lake water issues and the region.
That's what we're talking about.
Mr. Lanoue, please. be respectful. It's starting to go off in a different direction here. I've got a lot of other people who have got some concerns that we want to try to get back to the water issues. I know I've got some issues and hands going up over in this area here. I'll start up in this corner on this side here. Sir.
My name is Gary Bauman. I'm retired, but in 1990 I was at a meeting. There was only five of us to discuss this, the groundwater issue, and one of the other people are here. I forgot her name. But at the time, it was predicted what White Bear was going to do because they had five pumps going in the metro area, and that was when Woodbury started going. They've got 17 pumps now during the summer, three during the winter. Hugo stopped their development a few years ago because they couldn't catch up to the Met Council on the pumping and the other end of it, which was going down. But even the St. Paul Water Department started pumping water in the ground. And I kind of get a kick out of it because they're going to sell water back to the White Bear, so they're pumping out the thing with one straw and going over the other. And the reason they're doing that is it's cheaper to treat groundwater than it is river water. So the people in St. Paul are getting a good deal. They're saving millions by not doing this. The same thing's going in Woodbury. One of the problems I think you have to look at is stopping all this pumping that's going on. That's one of the problems, but you're not going to change people's attitudes because I still want to irrigate my lawn, I want to wash my car, and the people in Woodbury ain't going to go for that, even though they're sucking water out. And it goes, I don't want to pick on Woodbury, but everybody else is doing it.
I look comes down. This gentleman here, and then this lady. I saw him.
Greg Parisel, proud resident of White Bear Lake. Thank you very much for all the work that you guys have done. It's very important. Can you tell us water conservation being a big issue? And Gary has just alluded to it. Can you tell us how much time and effort you looked at water conservation?
And I'm going to probably defer to a couple others who may have a little bit more information on. I know that, first of all, for water conservation, the White Bear Lake Chamber has been leading a very aggressive effort. We've got Tom Snell over here, who's from the executive director of the White Bear Chamber. They've been leading an effort for the last couple of years, working with the local residents and with the businesses to help find ways to do conservation, because that's going to be some of the quickest ways that we can pull back on what we're using for water. That's one of the things that we've got that's happening in the process. We still have a lot of work to do in those areas, and someone is talking about how we, as we heard from the other gentleman up here, you know, what people are going to be doing for irrigating their lawns, what they're going to be doing for washing cars, etc. One of the things I know that one of the reports I saw, I don't know if it was in the Met Council report or not, is I saw somewhere where they were listing how much each of the communities average for personal use, for their personal consumption on domestic, and it varies widely across the region. There's a lot of them that are very below average, there's a middle average, and then there's people who are using substantially more. And I think that's one of the things that we have to take a look at and figure out how does that have an equation in there as we go forward. Because as was mentioned, is people who are pumping from the ground pay much less than people who are using surface water. And so these are the things that are going to come into effect, is how do we become more conservation minded? What are things that we can do? Ali.
We have been working with communities in the region for, they have been trying to introduce a concept to many of the residents in the area. And they are trying very hard, working with the chamber in White Bear Lake, city of White Bear Lake, Mahmoudai Township. All of those communities, they are trying their best. And if you can look at the water used by city of White Bear Lake over the last 5 years, it was reduced by 20%, which is a good sign that we're going into the right direction. Communities are understanding there's some issues and we need to deal with that. A couple of things that we are doing in Met Council regarding conservation. We are, we received funding for evaluation of how much industries in the Northeast are using and suggest for them some conservation measures that they can use to reduce their water use. We have done this in the other parts of the metro area. It's a successful program that we run in conjunction with the University of Minnesota, and the results were really impressive. We have done three areas over the last years. We have done three industries, And for each one of those, the saving is very significant. The total annual saving for the three together is about $400,000. This is money saved because they reduced their water. One of the industries, they cut back their water use by 35%. We are trying to have, using the funding we received, to implement some of those, to select some of the industries, work with them in establishing or providing them information so that they can reduce their water use. One of our plans also in the Met Council, we are planning to start a grant program for conservation measures, demand reduction measures. Hopefully it will be funded next year in the coming biennium. We are planning, this is mainly for municipalities so that they can use to either toilet swabs, improve outdoor water use, or reduce commercial buildings' water use. This is, as of now, we are planning for a $1 million project or $1 million for 2 years as a pilot project. We want to run first to see how this is gonna work, and then if it's successful, then we'll expand it in the future.
Thank you, Ellie, great. Before I get to you, sir, I see the lady with the pink top here.
Just very quickly, I know everyone is very concerned about the cost of water and the cost in general for things. And I know we all want to wash our cars, like they said, and water our lawns and so forth. But we're also concerned long-term about the infrastructure and what we have to put into things. One of the things which will force us to conserve is to bring the cost of water up. And to be honest with you, when I look at the cost of water throughout the United States, we pay nothing compared to the rest of the country, and it's causing this, that's becoming part of our problem. If the price of water goes up, we all hate to see that, but it's going to force us to be more careful in how we use water. So I think that needs to be part of the equation in looking at things. Instead of how much does it cost to do something, long-term, what's it going to cost us versus paying a little bit more for each gallon of water.
I was wondering whether or not the cost estimates for bringing in the water from St. Paul and other places, they're going to include amortization costs for the wells that the municipalities already have in place.
Good question.
Yes, we're taking the final report that will be included.
Is that in the numbers that are out in your
No, the numbers currently produced, no.
Thank you.
Okay, see, but before I want to get to some of the others, you, sir, second row here.
Tony Russo, formerly, I'm sure you know, Yamada-Midai. One question, one comment from the council report. Both of the first two options, whether diverting untreated water through Lake Charlie area or diverting treated water from St. Paul North, have multiple phases to them, adding some of the near cities first and then the outer minor lakes and so on a little later. And the question is, first, do we need to pick an approach right off the bat, or could you potentially divert treated water from the near cities first, and then later on either decide you're diverting the untreated just for the farther out communities, or divert for those and do this, you know, switch what we did for the near cities? Do you have to pick a route now, or can you do some and then switch it around, connect them up later? And then the other part of that, I don't know a lot about the legal framework behind this, but as I understand it, there is some financial impact to municipalities by how you do that kind of stuff. For instance, right now, Arden Hills gets St. Paul treated water, but what actually happens is Roseville buys it, and then Arden Hills buys from Roseville. And I don't know if there's a markup going through Roseville. So we might need to have some action at the state law level to not have us be doing things that don't make sense because they're cheaper within a small realm when the regional solution would make sense some other way.
I'll turn it over to Ollie for that. One of the things I know that in the full draft report they have that's 100 some odd pages, it gets into some of that discussion. So if Ollie, you could get onto that, that'd be great.
And I think you raised a very important issue, that's what the alternatives that we tested or we analyzed at this time, they're not the only alternatives. There is many of those combinations that communities can do. You can connect six here, you can connect then later on, connect five, then or can connect only those three, and then the rest of them is going to be another phase. So what we tried to select kind of a basic alternative system that we developed, which is the phase that you have seen in those. But again, this is as you mentioned, it could be very complex. You could develop so many of those options and alternatives so that you can analyze. But because we have a limited time, first of all, and limited funding, we picked only those three with the different alternatives. For your second question, the financial implications on municipalities, what you mentioned is correct about St. Paul. St. Paul maintained two types of agreements with communities. The first one is wholesale, where they provide the water to a certain location. The community pick that up. The community responsible for distribution, billing, maintenance of their system, and they pay a wholesale rate for sample. On other communities, they have a different system where they call it retailer, where they took over the system of that city, and St. Paul is the one who is managing the system, maintaining the system, building the residents, and responsible for the distribution system. So you have two systems, and based on which one you are picking, you have different terms for your agreement with St. Paul system.
Third row up over there, gentlemen, in the long black sweat shirt. Tom Lyons, Whitebear Lake owner. Will the final report have a timeline for implementation of the various proposals?
Yes, so for sure. We have a timeline of, there is one of the things that we are not sure about, which is the funding. If you are going what I'm going to provide in the last report, assuming that you have funding, you have permits, and then how long it will take to build that system and have it operational, we'll provide that information. That's an engineering information that we'll provide.
Also, one thing that I wanted to kind of ask, building off the question you had, is one of the things that you're looking at is the reports that that council is doing. One thing we have to keep in mind that the USGS is still doing their survey work, and that's gonna be another 2 to 3 years out, and depending some of the things that they find may have impacts is how things get treated again for White Bear Lake itself proper. And so these are some of the things is what we're hearing now can potentially change and evolve going forward as new information becomes available. I think that's one of the things we want to make real clear. I know that Jason Meckel from the DNR is shaking his head up now, is that this is a process that we've not done a lot of work on. We don't have all the information. So it's going to be something that we're going to have to continue to engage as a community as we have new information come out. Right here in the middle, Eddie.
Eddie Wexstrom from Shoreview. The maps that I've seen show that the areas that are going to have the problem first are probably going to be like the Woodbury, Cottage Grove area, areas just kind of south of the Mississippi River. But it seems like this report just addresses the White Bear Lake area. So how will this impact those other areas, or will there be other studies looking at what they need to do in the future?
We have been working with six communities in South Washington County to establish a similar study like what we are doing in these communities here in the North and East. And this, we are in the final stages of when to start that study. We selected a consultant to do that, and we are finalizing the scope of work for that study. It includes options that some of them similar to what we have here in the North and Northeast, but it also includes other options that might not be available except in Washington County. And we are, hopefully we'll start this soon, and we're planning to end this study by the end of the year also.
Wow, lots of hands going up.
Peter, three issues here. First, I mean, we're talking, have the Met Council over here, we're talking regional water management. Of course, I bought the thing, we'll do insight into it, move dollar. And we're talking about high quality, you said high quality surface water, groundwater management. Well, there was the article in the Pioneer Press about 3M pumping out of the aquifer, how many millions of gallons, billions, to create a negative pressure and then dump that water into the river, and it lowers the aquifer. So what's being addressed on that? Then you you take this this issue that was brought up here of Lost Lake and the Bel Air sanitation site that was an industrial dump which had all kinds of chemicals in it. And so when that school was put in there and you punctured the seal, those contaminants that person is talking about have now flow along the outside of the water and sewer lines and flow into Lost Lake. From Lost Lake, they flow into White Bear Lake. From White Bear, they go down into the aquifer and are now distributed region-wide. You know, I can see why those people didn't want to have a school built on a dump site. We can go into that, but you and Mr. Wiger did a lot to defeat that legislation. There was the...
White Bear Lake, please.
Region. The other part is all this water that's being pulled up out of the aquifer in the wells. And then we're told that water is no longer put out back on the ground in septic systems or however, but go into a sewer system, go down to Pig's Eye, and get pumped into the river after they're treated. Now, you're totally depleting the aquifers. There was two major ways there. How are those being addressed? How are you going to replenish the aquifer? And then you talk about taking water from the Mississippi River. Now, I've seen plans or discussions that talk about taking it from the St. Croix because you have a absolutely perfect government-owned right-of-way that could come all the way into the lake, and that water is cleaner than the Mississippi. So why are we just focusing on the Mississippi as the source of the water?
All right, let me first of all, you were asking about the 3M pumping over there. Mr. Putzier from the DNR, I know that you've been kind of looking at some of the options that might be happening.
Hi, Bob. Paul Putzier with the Department of Natural Resources. Quickly, 3M, very important that we continue to pump water from the middle of that plume to control the migration of those contaminants. That's the first thing. It's very important. That's being managed by the Pollution Control Agency. On the other hand, a lot of that water that's being pumped is being used by 3M. They pump it 6 miles down to the plant. They don't use the wells that they have on site because they're using the water from those wells. So that water is actually being used twice to some degree. It's being used to protect the aquifer from the contaminants moving, and it's also being used in the process for the materials that they produce out of the economic engine down there in 3M. But it's interesting, and we need to think about it differently. New Brighton, another large pollution plume, they use that water for city water. One great example, Baytown, another Washington County, large pollution plume, that water is pumped, treated, and replaced into the aquifer. It's not nearly the volumes. And the third one is this one. So they're all a little different. And I think we do need to work more to try to figure out how to use that water. But we're not going to be able to slow down. I know a couple of years ago, the Pollution Control Agency did a study with 3M to see if they could cut back, because they're pumping a little over 1 billion gallons a year from those four wells in the middle of Cottage Grove Woodbury. So good question, Bob. Thanks.
Just to add to the 3M issue, as I mentioned, we are working with South Washington County communities and coming up with the study for those communities. The first option they want to analyze is reuse of 3M water. So those communities are aware of what's happening. They want to reuse that water, and as you mentioned, it's a significant amount of water that's going to pump, but it's needed. You cannot avoid that. So the part of the study that Woodbury, Cottage Grove, and other communities in the Washington County are planning to do, this is the first option that they want to analyze to see what's the potential for using this water for either potable and non-potable use. Second, you mentioned about the wastewater. The Met Council is hopefully by the end of this year or early next year We have a wastewater reuse plan that will be released to the public, looking into potential for locations where the reuse of wastewater is available. There's wastewater that could be used. And still, it's an issue that need, as you mentioned, as you know, this is going to be the first time that we're publishing the reuse plan, because it hasn't been an issue for a long time. And again, you know, the agencies who are permitting the reuse needs to look into this issue of allowing how we can reuse our wastewater.
How does the DNR, I have a follow-up question. When the DNR holds the water through those studies, how does the aquifer pull out my reuse?
Mr. Zick, there's other people who'd like to ask questions. You've had a chance to get three out. I'd like to get some other people who are asking questions. I'll start here, 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 and here up there, and that will run. So we'll go right up the center right here, and then over to the gentleman by the hands.
I just have a couple of comments. My name is Paul Ellison. I'm president of the Ramsey Metro Watershed District. And for the Met Council, I know that they're doing the studies on the costs and the technical aspects of groundwater. But I make a plea to them to also, in their recommendations, make some recommendations with regard to the governance of all of these issues that exist within this metropolitan area. Maybe, you know, when you look at the fact that there are just simply a large number of agencies and organizations that are engaged in this, they include the DNR, Public Health, Bowser, the Legislature, Met Council, U.S. Geological Survey, city governments, county governments, et cetera, et cetera. And one really needs to say, what is the governance structure that we truly need metro-wide to deal with this metro-wide issue? And it just may be that the Met Council needs, in the water area, needs to move on and be more of an implementing agency and maybe more of a regulatory agency. Now, that really will fly in the face of a lot of local folks who cherish local control and government. But this is an issue that is really broad in scope and needs a better governance structure. And I just would plead with the Met Council as they go through their study process here the next through October that they look at those kinds of issues.
Thank you, sir.
Right behind you. Thank you. Doug Bean, White Lake City Council. I believe Ali said that the final report will indicate a time to implement the particular solutions. What about a time to recover or to see those solutions be effective? If it took 35 years for this to happen, 35 years is going to be too late or too long to see a recovery. So we need to make sure that whatever implementation takes place can be timely.
All right. Next person.
First of all, I want to thank all the work that this bipartisan group has done in looking at solutions for our water needs. The question I have is, if these projects, a lot of them are very substantial in nature, if they take, you know, if they go forward and they take a significant amount of time in order to implement these various solutions, what's going to happen to White Bear Lake during that period? If it takes a number of years, and one of the reasons that we're here is to find ways to substantially keep White Bear Lake at least where it is, can we wait the amount of time that's going to be needed in order to implement these long-term water solutions? And are there any immediate steps that can be taken short of voluntary conservation?
Anyone from the council or DNR want to try to field it? Okay, gentlemen in the back, you have questions?
No answer?
Two.
Yeah, there. Well,
I didn't get an answer either.
That's the reason we're all here, right? Well, what is the immediate action that could be taken? I just want to hear something, anything.
Well, the immediate, I think what we've got is we've got several things that we're trying to hear. We've got long-term, we're also, yeah, you're right. What is the short-term solution?
And I think the communities decided on that. They started implementing conservation efforts, that many of the communities are trying to do that. And
the short term, that's one of them. We are planning to do, as I mentioned, we have 16 options that we were looking at about a year ago. Some of those options is working with stormwater. And we got funding for identifying where are the best reuse of stormwater. That might be an interim options for the communities that instead of waiting for longer to reduce their groundwater reliance and replace that with any other sources, it might be easier to do stormwater. And this is gonna be part of what we are providing to the community. This information we're gonna provide it and the communities need to make the decision. Again, the implementation, you mentioned that some of these projects is gonna be long, but even for the, there was an assumption that lake augmentation is gonna be the easiest, the quickest, and it's not. You have to go through a lot of logistics before you can pump water, build, first of all, build a system, and put water into the lake. We are dealing with permitting, we are dealing with impairments in the Mississippi River with the zebra mussels. We want to make sure that that's not gonna be an issue in White Bear Lake. Nutrients difference, if any one of the agencies is telling us that you need to treat for the phosphorus or nitrogen because it's more in Mississippi than White Bear Lake, that's gonna put more. So there is a lot of complex issues that we are dealing with. We will hope that we'll provide information, but again, you know, I truly don't know what will be the best short terms until we finalize our analysis. And hopefully we'll have some ideas that we can provide to communities so that they can implement in the meantime while we are waiting for any other options.
Ali, could I rephrase a little bit? Is in the final report that comes out then, are you going to be having something that's going to say this is what can be done, like a 1 to 2 year solution, a 3 to 5 year solution, a 10 to 15 year solution type of thing? So we can see that kind of progression?
Representative, what we are providing, if you want to build approach A, it will take you from securing the funding, it will take you this time for what you need to do. In the meantime, we're going to say that communities need to start working in conservation. We're going to provide what kind of measures that they can do. Reuse of stormwater, we'll try to provide information of what available opportunities for them to do and where are the best locations to do that. Also, we are looking into groundwater recharge. Where are the best locations to increase our groundwater recharge? And this is part of work that we are planning to do in the next 6 months.
Two points, actually. One is, I've gone out looking for the information. I know Mr. Ali just put out the report today, evidently, so he didn't tell me that it was out there yet. Sorry. I'll give you the grace on that one since you're kind of busy. The other one is for the U.S. Geological Service and for the DNR. I know that the last meeting you had a report from one of those. I've not been able to find those. Can you guys give us hints as to where those earlier reports might be?
The USGS one or the?
USGS and the DNR. Then I'll just broach the second one because Charlie just broached on what I was going to ask, and that is I know White Bear City Council decided that they didn't want to use the rainwater, probably because of phosphorus and fertilizers contamination, and that's being piped, from your last meeting you said it was being piped down to the treatment facility in St. Paul and then into the river, so it seems like a fairly heavy penalty for the basin here to be pumping all that water out.
Let me do a couple things because there's a couple things that were asked there. USGS reports.
Yeah, that's available on our webpage. Just to find it, you could type any search engine, type USGS White Bear Lake, and it usually goes right to that site.
I found your hydrology meter there, but I didn't find the report.
Oh, okay. Well, it should be there. The other place to check, it's on the White Bear Lake Conservation District. They have a link to that report. You can check their webpage. Otherwise, I can help you out.
And I think the other report you might be, the DNR one, is that the 1998 report that the DNR did?
I think it was the one you had at the last meeting.
Yeah, the DNR did a report on the area in 1998 that I had a copy of, and I can't remember where I downloaded it.
Probably. I think that might be on the Conservation District website as well.
Yeah,
that's probably the easiest way, White Bear Lake Conservation District. And they've been doing a nice job accumulating these documents. might be harder to find on our website.
Okay, and then I know there's a couple folks from Wiper Lake here. There's something about the stormwater, and I
I'm not clear what he's saying. I'm not clear what he's saying. I've never been, and I don't.
I think if I'm understanding what was coming up is that on stormwater, a lot of stormwater gets collected goes from Mississippi. And Wiper Lake, how does most of this, what's happened with most of your stormwater with rain gardens? I know rain gardens are going on.
We have stormwater prevention programs in place and things like that. We're complying with the law.
Oh, I understand. I remember meeting with your administrator, Mark Slater, who's in the back there. In some areas, if I understood, please correct me if I'm wrong, you were doing some places where you were collecting that storm water. It was getting running through a filtration system,
yeah.
Some kind of going back toward the lake.
Yeah.
Okay, so those are things that have been starting to, as you've been doing, redeveloping your streets, et cetera. Yeah. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Isn't the bulk of that water still at this time going down to the Mississippi River?
From the region. You know, I don't know who would have the best information on that. I know that region-wise, there's a lot that heads down. I don't know where all the water from, you know, specifically from the Wiper Lake watershed goes. I don't know if Mr. Slater in the back might have that, or anyone from the DNR or Met Council might know that information, or where we can even find that.
You know, White Bear is, you know, less than 4 square miles of lake. It's right. That a real huge amount of area. And on the south side of the lake, there's 6 square miles of area. But I'm under the impression that water right now all goes to the Mississippi River. Yeah. It seems like a real local amount of water that potentially.
Mark,
I don't want to get down into the weeds too much, but the city of Wiper Lake is in 4 different watersheds, and water runs downhill. So all the water that's in Rice, the water within the Rice Creek Watershed District within the city flows into White Bear Lake, the body of water. In the south part of the city, for instance, in the Ramsey, Washington Metro, part of it is in the Valamo, the Vadnais Lake area. So it goes into the Grass Lake, the whole series of lakes. Eventually, all the water that falls on the surface in the Twin Cities, if it doesn't become infiltrated, goes into the Mississippi. We're all in the southern Mississippi watershed. So yes, it does get there, but the city's preferred water treatment system is a series of wetlands and rain gardens and infiltration. All of our street projects end up with capturing the first 2 inches of all the rainfall, and it is incorporated right back into the soil within the watershed that it's in.
All of southern White Bear Lake.
Well, it depends on the part of South White Bear Lake. This area here in the college goes into St. Croix,
okay.
Which goes into the Mississippi. So you're not wrong. I mean, every
like White Bear Avenue and McKnight all run, you know, right to the lake. But that water doesn't just run into the lake.
No, parts of McKnight go into the lake. Parts of McKnight go into Vadnais Lake. Parts of McKnight go into the chain of lakes through the Phelan chain of lakes.
Okay. Thanks.
The lady up in back here.
Yeah, I was just going to say I'm with Rice Creek Watershed District.
Oh,
and
okay.
Yes, and I know. And then water, strangely, it goes north. It goes all the way up to Hugo. It goes into the lake, chain of lakes. It goes down in Nook, and it ends out in Fridley. So it all goes into the Mississippi. You're absolutely right, Ian.
Okay, very good. I see that we're about at 7:30. We've been at this for about an hour and a half. I want to be respectful of people's time through here. I do know that what I'd like to try to do is bring it together as a close. I know that I'll be staying afterwards for anyone that has questions. I'm imagining some of the folks through here will be able to stay and help answer individual questions. Some things I want to kind of mention on is, as you're hearing, this is a very complex issue that's not, it didn't happen overnight. It's not going to get solved overnight. But we are working collaboratively to try to address the solutions and move the solutions forward. One of the things that I did not mention earlier that is happening is and this kind of goes to one of the comments that was brought up earlier, is the state legislature has reinstated this Legislative Water Commission. This was a commission that they had a number of years ago that was dealing with water issues back that we had about a decade and a half ago. That has been reestablished to start addressing those issues. I want to mention that there's a number of folks in the room who are serving on. Representative Dean here has been appointed to it. There are 12 people that have been appointed to it. Representative Dean is one of them. Senator Wiger, Senator Chamberlain, Senator Scalzi, and myself. There are 6 seats on this commission. Out of those six, or excuse me, there's 12 seats. 6 seats out of the House, 6 seats out of the Senate, and in each chamber, it's evenly divided between parties, 3 between Democrats and 3 between Republicans. So in terms of 12 throughout the state, this region has a very heavy influence representation on it. So a lot. So what I want to say is a lot of comments that you're mentioning here tonight, we're going to be listening very closely to and keeping that in mind, because this commission will be starting off in September. The other things that I will be mentioning too is that you're mentioning about looking at the local governance and how things go back and forth. There was a report that was done back a couple of years ago using Clean Water Legacy Funds. And it goes to, it's called the Minnesota Water Sustainability Framework. And this was a report that came out that addressed a lot of this, what we're dealing with here today, are also the same issues other parts of the state are having, and in some cases, even different kinds of problems. And some of the things that we were talking about earlier are highlighted in this report, saying these are things that we have to look at and try to address going forward. And they're broken out. Some of them are a little bit shorter, I think, but most of them are medium to long-term impacts before we're going to have things happen. I know as the Legislative Water Commission gets going, this is one of the frameworks that we're going to be looking at. This was taxpayer dollars that helped put this together from legacy funds. And what's great about this is it's got some good benefits that we'll be able to use going forward. I thank you all for being here tonight. We'll be here afterwards, and take care. Thank you very much. Thank you.